on the stage.
Joseph Cotton, man, as a Citizen Kane, go for it. Ask me a good question. Where fire can come from the sky and bring flame into the room.
People will bootleg this tape on the outtakes. Here we go.
You know, it's very hard to remember all this stuff because memory is kind of like a thin gauzy veil that's pulled down between you and the actual event that happens, and you forget a lot and it's kind of distorted. And I really don't remember a whole lot about that night, but I do remember going to Rodney's English Disco. My cousin and a friend of the family took me up there. We hitchhiked to Hollywood, got a ride with some like cholo guys in the back of a van, and we were smoking pot, and we went up there, and I think it was Rodney that had introduced me to Kim. Well, he was like, this is Kim Fowley. And I was like, hi. You know, I didn't know who he was or what he did. I didn't know anything about him. And he was like, well, she's a songwriter, you know. And they laughed at me because I was a kid. I was like, you know, 13 years old. So they were like, well, let's hear what you got. So I laid some of my stuff on him, and they shut up immediately. And Kim was like, here's my number. Kim wants to know every little thing. You know, what do you listen to? And then he went on his spiel to say who he was and what he did.
You know who Gene Vincent was? He's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I was his producer, one of the seven guys who produced him. I produced new music sequences for American Graffiti. My name's on the screen. The first platinum rock and roll soundtrack album. That's who I am.
So we would talk on the phone, and I would recite my stuff to him, and he liked it a lot. Oh, and he was like, you know, I work with a lot of people. I think that I should sign you to a contract. And I signed the contracts on my 14th birthday. Well, I used to see Joan on the bus. I think I spoke to her that I want to start a band, you know? And then I think her response was like, why don't we start a band? If Susie Quattro can do it, we could do it.
We were on tour in America,
And I saw this girl sitting in the lobby of the hotel. I think it was the Continental Hyatt House. And she had my jacket, my haircut. And she was waiting for me to arrive.
She's got the jeans, she's got the black shirt, she's got the sunglasses, she's got the haircut, she's got the look. This girl looks like a junior Susie. But she doesn't talk to Susie, she doesn't approach Susie, she doesn't talk to anybody. She just sits there, and she's in the lobby all day.
And then I saw her after that at just about every show in the lobby of every hotel, bless her.
Susie was a little, I would say put off, but a little wary. And I think it was also, without regard to reality, Susie being very straight, very married, was always a little bit wary about female fans coming on too strong and what their motives were. You know, was it sexual?
Joan Jett was like Gary Cooper. She didn't say much. Or like Clint Eastwood. Yeah? Okay. You ready to work? Uh-huh, yeah. You want to kick ahead? Yeah. Do you want to take over the world? You bet I do. Okay. Let's go find some people who want to do that, too. So we did.
My friend said, you want to go to Starwood? We're going to hang out and see some bands and then, like, trip around town. And I went to Starwood, we watched a band, and then like everybody, all the stars hang out at the Roxy and the Rainbow afterwards, the parking lot. And my friend goes, that's Kim Fowley, who's like written for Kiss and Alice Cooper. So I marched right up to him. I said, listen, I'm 15 and a half years old. I've been playing in live rock bands since I was 13, been drumming since I was 9. Here's my number. He went, well, as a matter of fact, I'm working with a 14-year-old lyricist. I think she knows she has a friend in the valley that I think plays electric guitar. The next night he calls with Joan's number. So I give Joan a call, and I got a drum set, a Marshall amplifier, a Les Paul guitar up in my room. You know? You want to come on down and jam with me? She goes, well, all I really know is I play the records, and I just know Susie Quattro numbers. Ma, I don't care, whatever. I'm playing Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath. So she comes down 3 buses later to Huntington Beach from the valley. Little Sears guitar, real quiet, real meek, little leather jacket on, little Susie Quattro hairdo. So we start jamming on one of Susie's songs. I went, God, this has got good rhythm, you know? She stays on top of it.
Okay, in Hollywood, our drummer Sandy and I met our producer Kim Fowley at you know, a different time during the week. And we got together, Sandy and I, and jammed. Uh-huh. And it sounded really good, so the two of us got together, and Kim and Sandy and I found the other girl.
I see. Okay.
Joan actually came to our house first, and they started jamming out. And then Kim. Well, when Kim walked in our door, he was bad news, as far as I was concerned. First of all, he walked in an orange suit, and I saw this big, enormous guy come in my door. I didn't know whether to throw him out or laugh at him.
They were nervous. They didn't understand. They were concerned. Your young daughter venturing and meeting a Hollywood producer was probably not the thing they were expecting me to come home with.
As I look back, and Sandy won't agree with me, I should have tied her to the bed and said, you can't do this. But you know, you can't really take your children's dreams away. You have to be there and support them and love them, no matter what, and that's really what that all turned out to be.
At that point, when that little rendezvous was shaped up down at Sandy's house, she was playing, Joan was playing, and I was there, and I remember, I don't know if Kim called or I called him, and he was like, well, have him play so I can listen over the phone. From then on, it was pretty much out of my hands, because he smelled money. He's not stupid. You know, and from then on, I was just like, I'm just gonna write songs for the band and just, you know, take a little backseat. I mean, what could I do? I was just a songwriter. I was a teenager, you know?
Yeah, I was dancing at a club called the Starwood one night, and Rodney Bingenheimer was walking up to every girl there saying, do you play an instrument? Do you play an instrument? And I said, yeah, I play guitar. And he said, how old are you? And I got real cocky, and I said, 15. And Rodney almost wet himself right then and there. Said, oh, you have to come with me right now. Come see Kim Fowley. He's putting together this band called The Runaways. So a couple of friends of mine and I got in a car with him and drove over to meet Kim Fowley, which is an experience I will never forget. We walked in, it was this tall freak with this disaster of an apartment and just this very overwhelming presence. And as soon as I walk in, Rodney says, well, this is gonna be your new guitarist. And Kim looks at me and says, great, well, on the road, it'll be a battle between you and the drummer for who's gonna be the leader of the band, and they'll all wear heels and you won't, so you're the same height when you walk in everywhere. And he had me scared shitless. He had me convinced that Sandy was gonna beat the crap out of me at the audition. So, of course, I walk into the audition just not knowing what to expect. And the only band members at the time were Joan and Sandy. And I walk in and Joan is standing there in front of this massive Marshall amp. And the only song that all three of us knew was Kiss's Strutter. So that's what I played auditioning on lead guitar. And I hated them, they hated me. So that was it. I did not get into the band.
The very first phone conversation I had with Kim Fowley, he pumped me up so big. I mean, we're gonna tour the world, play in front of thousands of people, make lots of money. And I mean, holy shit, you know, how could anybody refuse? So I packed up my gear and I drove into Hollywood and auditioned. Everything that he said to me was in my mind when I walked in that room. I was on tour already. I was playing the arenas and playing the stadiums. And, you know, what he didn't tell me was that I was going to have to work my ass off for years and years and years and years. And then maybe you can buy yourself a new Corvette.
The really exciting part was when Lita Ford came down to audition for bass. She brought her Gibson SG guitar, too. So on break, when those guys were out of the room, we started playing a Deep Purple. She brought the electric guitar, man. I was just, wow, God, this is great. This girl can play guitar.
Sandy and I hit it right off. We're both listening to Deep Purple. We're both huge Deep Purple fans. So I went in and I rattled off the guitar solo to Highway Star. And Sandy automatically knew, you know, the drum parts, all the drum parts to Highway Star. So me and her just jammed on that song and fell in love with each other. By the end of the song, it was automatic bonding. And Joan sort of stood there going, oh, this is great, man, this is great. Cool.
I was very excited to get lead in the groove because I thought it was a good contrast of having Joan such a great rhythm and then having Lita to be able to solo and flavor things.
We all got along great, and I loved everybody except for Kim Fowley. He really got on my nerves. He kept calling me names, calling everybody dog puck and scum.
He prefixed everything with the word dog in front of it. Dog shit, that's not right. Do it again.
And of course, I think it was all in fun. It was just trying to get a charge out of us, you know, and get us to like show some emotion. Well, I showed so much emotion, I just packed up and left. One day, the girls called me and they said, Lita, we want you to come back. And I said, yeah, but Kim is a Fruit Loop and he drove me crazy and how am I gonna deal with him? And you know, the girls felt the same way. They were like, yeah, he's a lunatic, but you know, deal with it.
I enjoyed being different. You know, being a twin, I was really fighting to find my own identity. You know, my twin sister was always the prettier one. She was the cooler one. She always had all the friends. I was the meek twin, the runt. So we met Kim Fowley at the Sugar Shack. I was sitting at the bar drinking a Coke, and he walked up behind me, tapped me on the shoulder, and first thing he says is, my name's Kim Fowley. I'm a producer. Do you sing or do you play an instrument?
I don't know that it was a conscious thing that he said, oh, I'm going to go out and get me a thin blonde girl to balance this thing out, to make a contrast. But I think when he did see her, his mind probably sparked and went, this is perfect. This is something I can exploit. This is going to go good here.
Well, when Kim asked if I was interested in auditioning, and I said, absolutely, he took my phone number, called me the following day, and told me to learn a Susie Quattro song.
So out of all the songs on your Mama Won't Like Me album, I pick Fever, for Christ's sakes. I was terrified. I mean, I had sang Fever till it was coming out my ass. So Joan walks up and she goes, all right, what song did you learn? Of course, I say, Fever? She turns around, she looks at the girl, she goes, Fever? She picks Fever? So anyway, since no one knew how to play Fever, Joan and Kim wrote Cherry Bomb on the spot for me to audition to, and that was it. I was in the band. Now, did you hear that stomach growl?
I heard that. Don't worry, we'll be out.
Cherry Bomb was a song written as an audition piece for Cherie Curry, and it was a play on words on her name, Cherie, and Cherry Bomb, in my mind, meant the teenage firecracker that's popular at the 4th of July. And if you had a human firecracker up there who was blonde and kind of was Bardo-esque on a Sue Lyon Lolita level, it could work.
When we first started rehearsing, it was just Sandy West, Lita Ford, Joan Jett, and myself. Just to tell you how much I didn't know about music back then, I mean, I didn't even understand why we needed a bass player. Why do we need a bass player? And it sounds so good, you know? I was so naive.
Kim Fowley called me up and said, you know, we're looking for a bass player. I still think you'd be good in the band. Can you play bass? And I said, I don't know, I guess I can try. And I borrowed a friend's Gibson Ripper bass, and I took a couple of buses down to what ended up being our rehearsal place, this just awful trailer called Buds that had, you know, would have dog urine on the floor and sound system that never worked. And I went down there and I learned about 10 songs in half an hour, and that was pretty much it. Kim went around the room and said, do you want her in the band? And Joan and Sandy said yes. Lita said no. And Cherie persuaded Lita to let me join the band.
To be honest with you, I didn't really give a damn who we got. That's why I was pushing for Jackie. Not to down her at all, because I thought that she turned out to be really, really a real gem to add to the Runaways. I thought that she was very different. She had a quality about her that was very different from Joan or Lita or myself or Sandy. She was into the Fredericks of Hollywood garb that she'd wear all the time. The guys went crazy for that.
I didn't put the Runaways together. I had an idea. They had ideas. We all met. There was Combustion, and out of five different versions of that group came the five girls who were the ones that people like.
Lita had a really bad attitude. She was just like, fuck you, about everything. You know, and her and Kim fought constantly. If he said go slow, she drove fast. I remember being in the car with her. She came down to my house to pick me up. And she must have had that pedal down the whole way, driving really bad. Just like, I was like,
you can't be great on stage unless you learn the fundamentals of rock and roll savagery. And that's what we did in our boot camp daily rehearsals. I loved boot camp. I went to two branches of the service. I loved it so much. I wanted to share with the Runaways my love of boot camp. And I was the drill sergeant, and they were the recruits.
Well, you have to remember, there's like five teenage girls all in one room together that's hot and sweaty. And you put women together that work together, and eventually they're all going to start their period at the same time. It's just like a natural thing that happens. One teenage girl with her period is like a bundle of hormones. Five of them all at once, with Kim Fowley trying to like keep it all together, and his rhetoric is, you know, you can imagine what it was like. His barrage of insults. You get no pizza and beer until you finish this song. Dog shit.
Are you over it now?
I got the cramps. I need to take some Midol.
We had heckler's drill with garbage and toilet paper and trash cans that go flying across the rehearsal room, because maybe one day it would happen in Belgium or Arkansas or someplace. So they'd be prepared for it. And they were very good at dodging all that stuff, and they kept playing through all of it.
Well, he's quite difficult to understand, and it took a lot of understanding to figure out what the hell he was trying to do to everybody. You know, he had his ways of trying to make the girls stars, trying to get you to be charismatic. And, I mean, we're teenagers, you know? And he's calling us names and doing a whole bunch of other things, I suppose. You know, I don't really remember a lot of them. I just remember the name calling, which really bothered me.
We would walk into rehearsal, and he would pick up mic stands and throw them at us and scream, come on, you dog cunts, play this piece of shit.
All right, Lita. I was amazed, you know, how you play your guitar. When did you first start your guitar?
I started playing about 8 years ago, and I was 10 years old.
Oh, and by whom were you influenced by most?
Richie Blackmore, Jeff Beck, and Jimi Hendrix before he died.
Oh, I see.
It was sports. Runaways played sports. Runaways were strong. They were Amazons. They were part of the Amazon culture, like Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman was around then. Wonder Woman with guitars, minus the cleavage. Runaways were not TNA. Runaways were a sports team with musical instruments and teenage lyrics.
Since I didn't really play an instrument on stage, I didn't know what to do with myself. So I had suggested that maybe I should do costume changes. I was walking down Santa Monica Boulevard one day and I saw this white corset in the window of a little underwear shop right across from the Starwood. And I loved this corset. We bought it and I put it on and that was it. That was it.
Oh God, Vicky, I'm gonna kill you. I don't know when the corset appeared. As far as I know, it's always fucking been there, that fucking thing. Teenage jailbait. I mean, I guess it was like, well, okay, how can we make this situation here really jailbait?
The correction of that item, take three. We never thought of anything sexual. It was athletic.
I guess after living with Kim Fowley for a couple of weeks, you kind of get used to anything that comes along, even teenage girls in corsets.
Were the Runaways innocent? Of course they were. Were they theatrically bad girls? Of course they were.
I think there was a little bit of friction about the corset at first because I was wearing garters and fishnets and I was 16 years old. I think that the girls probably didn't like the idea that that would take a whole lot of attention away from them for that period of time. But when I wore it for the very first time on stage, the girls knew that that was the selling point for the song. And it was a hell of a lot of fun. It was my way to be a rebel and be 16 years old and out there in my underwear. I loved it.
That was the thing about the band. We hadn't been playing long enough to have any of our own style, so the Runaways was a group of five people imitating five different people. Cherie was David Bowie, Joan was Susie Quattro, Lita was Ritchie Blackmore, Jimi Hendrix. Actually, I don't know who Sandy thought she was, although probably a member of Queen. And I just thought I was Gene Simmons, even though my tongue trick was different.
We were trying to be who our heroes were, and that's what we knew how to do best. Our first record was done in 2 weeks. It was basically first takes. Girls would go in and we cut the tracks, and basically he threw me in the studio or Joan in the studio and have us sing the tracks twice. And then he just, unless there was a real mistake, what you got was, that was it.
So Kim decided that I wasn't gonna play bass on the first album. He kicked me out of the studio and hired Nigel Harrison, who went on to be the bass player in Blondie. So it's not actually me on the first album, it's Nigel. But Nigel trying to sound like what he thought I ought to sound like doesn't sound anything like me.
He didn't care. He didn't care how it really turned out. If it was good enough, if it was listenable, that was fine. Which actually made it very raw and very sellable.
I was trying to capture noise. I didn't break it down to fingernail polish or cup size. I'm looking for magic and noise. I want authentic slime. I want the golden garbage, and I succeeded. And so did they.
During the recording of the first album of the Runaways, I think my funniest memory, now it's funny, but back then it wasn't funny. It was when I spilled a Heineken on the console, and then I had to pay for it. And back then, I didn't have $750 to repair a console, which is what they charged me. So I was pretty upset about that. That was pretty stupid. So every day I was in the studio from that point on until now, until today, anything I'm drinking stays away from that console.
Cherie was an interesting duality person. She liked Eric Carmen and Barry Manilow. At the same time, she was growling out the rock and roll. You didn't know if it was going to be mellow or screaming, depending on the mood at the time.
There's nothing like getting up in the morning and being called dog piss. There's nothing like doing a great vocal or a vocal that you really thought, like me myself personally, some of the vocals I did, I was really happy with, and he'd turn around and say, "You dog, that sucks. Do it again." And to be completely honest with you, a lot of it, I think I blocked out. Well, I really knew the difference between right and wrong. So I knew what was happening to me was wrong. What was happening to Joan, Lita, Jackie, that was wrong. But we couldn't do anything about it because Kim was producer. He was manager. And he said, without him, we would go nowhere. First tour was 3.5 months. I'd never been away from home in my life. And my mother's main concern was that I was taken care of on the road. Kim fed everyone so full of bullshit, made all the parents think that we were going to be well taken care of, we'd have plenty of money, we were going to be playing these great places, we were all going to be stars.
Kim, you couldn't talk to him. From the very beginning, he walked in with this air of, you know, I'm going to make these girls great, I'm going to make them stars, and I'm going to do everything for them, and just a lot of promises that really didn't happen. Promises, the girls will definitely have tutoring, they'll definitely be chaperoned, we won't let them out of our sight.
And basically it was Motel 6's, McDonald's, and loneliness. I mean, it was an extremely lonely tour. I'll never forget the very first night we were on the tour bus. We were going through the Arizona desert, and I was hit with this horrible homesickness. It was just, oh, I mean, it hurt so bad. And I thought, my God, I can't do this. And I turned to Lita, and I was in pain. I was in the worst agony, and I said, I have to go home. And Lita turned around. She goes, do you think I'm not homesick? I want to be with my family, but when I come back, I want to be somebody. Scott Anderson came into the picture, I think, just about a few weeks after I joined the band. He was came in as the Runaways manager. He was kind of a geeky kind of guy with the briefcase under his arm. But he was cute, you know? He kind of had this little, like, puppy dog thing about him, you know? We all liked him. We all would seek a little refuge with Scott.
And a Now, did Cherie talk about Scott? Because Cherie was very involved with Scott.
I was just this little naive 16-year-old girl that shacking up with this, I guess he was 28, 29-year-old man, my father just did not see it. He didn't understand. He goes, what is wrong with this picture, Cherie? Oh, but Dad, it's real love. It really is.
I'm not sure how Scott Anderson got into the whole situation. He did manage the band, along with Kim Fowley. And I guess at one point, Kim was managing the band, writing songs with the band, producing the band. And I think the reason why Scott Anderson was brought in was because there was a conflict of interest there, because he was doing everything. Kim was doing everything.
Oh, well, here, you want the great story that everybody will kill me for? I walked into rehearsal one day, and everyone else is there. They're all sitting up on the stage at the front. And the instant I walk in the door, Kim looks up and just yells at me, did you sleep with Scott Anderson? And I said, hell no. There was a moment of dead silence. And then Kim said, well, you're the only one who didn't. So there was our responsible management.
Oh, Cherie and I, well, we didn't get along too good. She had a lot of things distracting her from what was important, and the music was important to me. And trying to become, you know, everything that Kim Fowley said we were gonna be in the very beginning. That was my goal. He'd wound me up with that very first phone call I received from him, and that was my goal. I had a vision, I had something to achieve, and that was what I wanted to do. And Cherie was really busy doing other things. Anyway, she was distracted a lot by other band members and management, drugs, cheeseburgers. I wasn't real, you know how a couple of the girls in the band would flock and hang together, and then another couple of the girls would sort of flock and hang together, you know? And Cherie and I were separate. There was Cherie and whoever, and then there was Lita and whoever. We just didn't really hang out that much. So whatever it was that Kim was doing to Cherie, or whatever it was that Scott Anderson was doing to Cherie, I only knew about it from behind closed doors. I wasn't real, we didn't talk, we didn't hang out.
I know that I had friendships and rivalries with other members of the band, but it was mostly either I was friends with Lita and not friends with Cherie, or I was friends with Cherie and not friends with Lita. And when I was on the outs with the two of them, those were the nastiest rivalries. We were playing in Texas somewhere, and Lita and I were sharing a room. And Lita stayed out all night partying, crawled back in at about 10 or 11 the next morning. So I wake up at 11, and I'm kind of sitting there in the dark trying not to bother Lita. And around noon, I needed to make a phone call. So I kept the lights off, I'm making this phone call. Lita wakes up and starts screaming at me to keep it down. And she finally gets so mad at me, she picks up the phone, hits me over the head with it, and tries to strangle me with the cord. At which point I ended up sitting in the lobby for 4 hours just to get away from her, because Lita mad was something you didn't want to see.
The Runaways had one tragedy that offended me. They weren't friendly with each other the way the Bee Gees probably were, because they were brothers.
Joan and I were as close as you could get, I think. What do you mean by how close, bitch? Of course, back in the 70s, there was this whole thing going on with bisexuality. David Bowie had come out of the closet, Elton John. And of course, I was such a Bowie fan. I had to check that out, you know? And that was kind of, that was all part of the magic, I believe, of that era of music and the free, not free, but free sex, basically, free-minded experimentation. And I did, I mean, I had a couple of fun times with Joan. And she was good, too, really good. We was Sandy too, you know, but I don't want to mention
it. Well, keep it rolling. Keep it rolling.
Okay. And Sandy wasn't half bad either.
So bad.
Am I bad? Thank you. That's what I'd rather hear. Love you too.
There was a distance that they all had between them. The runaways were from different neighborhoods, different backgrounds, and different schools who all joined one at a time a business enterprise. Like guys joining the army, they don't really know each other, and battle makes them friendly, but do they make them friends? I think that has a lot to say of why the band didn't continue, because they didn't have a lot in common with each other as people.
We were so competitive, and Kim Fowley and Scott Anderson so fed this, especially Kim. We were really encouraged to be jealous of each other and to be competitive with each other and not to be friends. People will sometimes ask me, you know, what do you think of Lita? What do you think of Joan? And the only answer I can make is, I don't know them. You know, I'm not the same person I was when I was 16, and we were all incredibly difficult in our own way. Cherie in the Runaways was the most self-centered person I've ever encountered in my life. Lita was just a bitch. Sandy,
I like just to have a good time whatever I do.
Sandy just didn't seem capable of independent thought. You know, she had the best of intentions, but was easily persuaded by whoever in the band, you know, she was friends with in that particular week. And Joan was probably, at the time, the most stable, the one who was really the peacemaker in the band.
It's hard to say. I just love what I'm doing. I love to play music, and I love to spend time with my friends and meet nice people.
And I was just incredibly insecure, a total know-it-all.
Most people our age have never left the state they live in. We've been all around the world.
And throwing us together was just a battle of the personality problems.
Jackie was a little bit more feminine than the rest of us, wanting to have long nails and long high heels and, you know, when none of the other girls really gave a shit what their nails or their heels looked like. She's a total hypochondriac. She always thinks that there's something wrong with her when there's nothing wrong with her, which drove everybody nuts to the point where we used to like spray deodorant at her just to make her sick, or she thought she was sick. She was like, oh, I can't breathe. But I love Jackie. I would room with Jackie. I'd hang out with Jackie. And you know, we'd usually end up arguing over a jar of Noxzema or something.
Kim Fowley, I trusted him. I had to trust him. I didn't want to, but I had to. This was a father figure for all of us. This was the man that gave us money when we needed a hamburger or we needed something to eat, cigarette money. We had no money. He never gave us any money. He was using us in every way, shape, and form.
He really abused Cherie mercilessly, much worse than the rest of us. I mean, Lita would just abuse him back, so we pretty much left her alone. I don't really know what he did to Joan and Sandy. But he would set us off against each other so we could never gang up, figure out what he was doing, and replace him.
Well, I'll never forget this one thing that Kim did. This was what I like to call Kim Fowley's sex education class. We were playing someplace in Whittier. Actually, we were opening for the Tubes. And he had gotten one hotel room. Of course, for all of us to change, some little sleazy hotel room. And we were all there, and there was this twin bed pushed up against the wall. And he has us all sit down. He goes, I am going to teach you all the right way to fuck. And we're sitting there saying, what? This he's not going to do this.
Kim used the tools that he had and he knew best how to use to try and keep the band in shape and whip it up. You know, that was his way, you know? I mean, I never saw him physically abuse or hit anyone or do anything like that, but verbally, he could be very abusive, you know? That's what he did to get the results that he wanted.
His manipulation, his ability to get control of us was by belittling us and by making us feel that we absolutely had no choice in what we were doing. We had no say in what we were doing. This man took a bunch of young kids, because we were talented and because we had something special. And in order to gain that control, he forced us into horrible situations.
Yeah, but there were so many people in our lives that were abusive. I mean, I don't know that Kim probably was more abusive than anybody else, but you kind of start getting used to the abuse and you no longer recognize it as abuse, which is part of what makes it abuse.
It's like when you're in the middle of something, it's really hard to step out and look at it. I mean, even to this day, people say, well, what was it like? And it's like, I can't say.
There's been a lot of allegations about Kim's abuse to and towards Savannah.
Yeah. I think that's pretty fair to say. He was verbally extremely abusive. You don't need to talk to anybody like that, call him the names he did. There was also emotional abuse to some of them, make their self-esteem. I wasn't included in that. Joan wasn't included in that. I don't think Lita was included. I think Cherie was included in that. I think Jackie was included in that. I think you were included in that. He seemed to pick on you guys pretty hard, verbally, emotionally, and belittling a lot. And I don't know what the difference was between, like, he didn't do that to me and Lita and Joe.
Fuck the hell, get the fuck out of my way!
Sexual abuse, possibly? Was there sexual abuse in the band with Kim Fallon? I'm not the person to ask.
Oh, I just can't believe. I mean, it is still coming back to us at this late date. Between 20 and 25 years, we found out just what these young girls went through.
You put a girl out that young, more or less on her own, not the promises that Kim Fowley made, and I'm still angry at this man.
I can hardly believe that that they could be, oh, I'm sorry, I can't put it into words.
There were times I thought I couldn't take another circumstance with the runaways because I was questioning things that were happening to them and what was going on. I would go to the studios. I would try to, you know, be on top of things, but it was like a closed door most of the time.
I think what Kim Fowley did is he put the girls together and whisked them away and out of town, you know, away from mom and dad. And so nobody knew really what was going on.
So the girls really got messed up. And we parents, I think, went through a lot. It was very stressful and many nights of not sleeping, and it was a very difficult time. And I think back sometimes maybe I didn't really concentrate as much as I should have on Sandy. You know, I don't know. I just know it was difficult. It was, after all, she was my baby too, you know. And we were always very close and still are, even through all difficulties. We remained that way, thank God. But, you know, there were times that I could have booted her in the fanny. That's awfully young to be out on your own.
Don Curry, that was Cherie's dad, was really causing him a lot of heartache. Was there any way that I could really tell him to, you know, back off? And I said, well, I don't know, what is he doing? Well, then we found out that he was really investigating Kim Fowley.
Kim would just go ballistic, and he would tell all of us girls or whoever, well, Cherie's father is causing waves. I'm telling you right now, if you don't make her stop, make her father stop, this whole thing is over. You know, so then all the girls would attack me. You know, I was like, all right, Dad, please. I love you. I know what you're trying to do, but let it go. Let it go, please. This is too much. I didn't want to be the downfall. I didn't want to be the one that was going to pull the plug. None of us wanted to be. There was just too much at stake, too much we thought was at stake.
And basically, I just kept an open line of communication with him. I didn't tell him everything, by God sakes, I couldn't have. My father would have absolutely pulled out a gun and blown his brains out. I still hope one day someone does. Because I think if anyone deserves it, that man does.
The European tour basically started off with a lot of drugs. Back then, you could get drugs from doctors. I remember some doctor, Scott Anderson, had convinced this doctor that I was suffering from fatigue, and so he prescribes me Placidals, and it was a jar, I swear to God, this big.
When we first went on tour, there was drugs involved, of course, but it seemed like it grew more and more and more and more and more. Then when we started playing overseas, the weather was cold, and the shows were outside. I remember my hands used to freeze before I went on stage. I couldn't play. My hands were so cold, so I would drink. I would have a few shots of something. It would warm me up to the point where I was, you know, I was okay. I'd go out on stage, and it was scary. There's so many guys. There's just like a sea of guys, a wall of guys. All dressed in black leather and denim, going, come on, baby. And I'd get nervous. I would get quite nervous.
The initial audience were horny males who were ugly, stupid, and couldn't hold their liquor, and they were teenagers. And a lot of riffraff and a lot of slime balls. And we united the slime balls and the kids in the suburbs together, and that became the core audience, along with a lot of girls who wanted to have big sisters out there kicking heads on their behalf.
I felt like throwing myself out my hotel window on a nightly basis after the shows. I was miserable there. But then the unfortunate thing was is that not only was I homesick, but then I started really getting sick when I was in Europe. And when I got home 2 months later, I was still sick. And one evening I was calling the cars, as they say, and my father walked in and said, this is it, I'm taking you to the doctor, and it turned out I was quick. So my poor father, he had to let me learn my lesson, but unfortunately, getting pregnant was not something that I had planned on, and it was something that, of course, I couldn't have handled.
Keep going, rock.
Queens of Noise recording session was absolutely wild. Oh God, what happened during Queens of Noise that I can actually talk about?
I don't have very many things that flash back in my mind about that. I can't remember. You know what? If I looked at the album and then saw where it was recorded and all that stuff, I probably have more things that flash back in my mind. Do you even know where the Queens of Noise was recorded?
I don't know.
Queens of Noise was pretty awful. That's when the real separation started between the five of us. I, of course, had to have an abortion in the middle of all of this. And Billy Bezo had written the song Queens of Noise for me to sing. He'd actually written it for me. And by the time I got to the studio, after spending 2 days in the hospital, Joan had already recorded it, which really hurt my feelings, because that was a song that I brought to the band. And that, I think, started some pretty ill feelings between me and Joan, because I just thought that was wrong.
I don't know if I want to bring that up, do I? Well, I guess you can edit it. Maybe I'll talk about it. You know, I was aware that there's drugs out there in the world, and I think that was my biggest worry. And the girls were drinking. So there was alcohol and drugs. And that just really changed a lot of their lives and our lives.
They really weren't talking, but you could tell that they were very hyped up, like speed, you know, with that really, they're a different personality altogether.
Anyway, we We found out that the runaway girls, including Sandy, were using drugs and drinking alcohol. And that was a real big concern with us. We just really were trying to deal with it. But how do you deal with it when your daughter's not really there under your own supervision? And that's another thing that I blame Kim Folley and anybody else that was associated with the runaways. They should have been watching them and been more aware of what was going on at that time.
We were starting to realize that it wasn't all Kim that made the runaways what the runaways were. It was us. It was us five girls. That's who did it. Kim, yes, he supplied the hype. He supplied the avenue to get there. But we realized we didn't need him, and we didn't want him. We were a lot happier without him.
Familiarity breeds contempt. Maybe they missed being teenagers. I was never told that because I was in my mid-30s then, so I was part of the authority that they were rebelling against.
We basically put our foot down and said, we don't want you around. You're not going to abuse us anymore. But by that time, we were pretty much abusing each other. We were just not making, we weren't enjoying this. It wasn't fun anymore.
That was another problem. Their age, how many 15-year-old people start businesses? And this was show business. This was the music business. This was work. It was fun, sort of. But after a while, it did become a grind, and it did become tedious work.
It was work. It had become a job. It was a chore. We didn't like being around each other. I was afraid to open my mouth because it always caused such a problem. We were fighting Jackie. It was just, we were all at each other's throats.
Our second tour, and Sheree and I think in particular ended up in a lot of fights on that tour, and we used to kind of do things to get back at each other. Sheree's were a lot meaner than mine. Mine were basically just meant to upstage Sheree, which used to really piss her off. But Sheree came up to me one night on stage and just took her big platform boot and kicked my bass. I mean, just let fly on the end of it. And I think that was kind of the moment that I just said, I don't want to do this anymore. I do not want to be in this band. And the reason I stayed in the band was because of Joan. I mean, she got down on her knees crying and begged me not to quit.
So we take this long plane flight to Tokyo. And what I remember is coming off the plane, and then all I remember is this deafening screaming, this screaming, these kids, and the police, and the cameras breaking, and the hands pulling, and this just screaming. It's just terrifying. Exciting, but at the same time, it was something that none of us expected.
Japan was really great. It was just, nobody knew it was gonna be that big. It was huge.
Yeah, so you got off the plane, and like they're holding everybody back on the plane. You get down to the crowd, and there's like 30 photographers at the end of the stairway, and rushed off to Susie Quattro's wedding reception or something, then a press conference. It was just one thing after the other. It was wild. Very successful, a lot of fun. Yeah, big.
It was the highlight of the Runaways' career, I would say. The most audience, most record sales. So that's what I remember. I had to buy another suitcase to bring home all the presents that people had given me. They'd given me so much stuff. Good gifts, too. Pearls and ivory earrings and neat stuff, books. Full of your own pictures.
For the first time, we each had our own hotel room. We were really treated like stars, and we promptly get up to our luxurious individual rooms where the promoter has thoughtfully laid out for us all of the magazines that were in Japan, and we pick them up and we look at one of them, and there are pictures that we had shot at a photo session at my mother's house. And as we turn the page, all of a sudden, there are these semi-pornographic pictures of Cherie in her corset and stockings posing up against a wall. She hadn't told any of us that she had done this. She had gone to this photo session and done her own photo session afterwards, and none of us spoke to her for like the next 5 days. We were so furious. So that was the start of our Japanese tour.
That wasn't a Japanese penthouse magazine. It was a magazine that they put out basically with me doing some shots and some not in some pretty what's the word?
Provocative.
Risque.
With me in some pretty risque fuck it. Let's just say that the body language was a little risque. I liked it, goddammit, because at that point, I was becoming the visual icon of the Runaways. And it was the next step for me.
But when the magazine came out, they went ballistic.
I'll never forget Lita walking up to me and just throwing it at me. You bitch. And I thought, I didn't do this. This wasn't my choice.
I believe to this day, those girls don't even realize that this was something that Kim had done. Because I never would have done something like that behind somebody's back. I loved these girls. They were my sisters. And Kim took that away.
Had a little trouble at the end. Went to go do the Tokyo Musical Festival, which was a big thing to be invited to. And it was 18,000 people. I mean, that's a lot. And Jackie was getting hysterical about that time. I don't know what she was complaining about. She wasn't feeling good, or she was tired of being tired. And supposedly, she was trying to hurt herself.
Jackie tried to kill herself. No. Yeah. Jackie went over the edge because she couldn't go to her own gynecologist when she was in Tokyo. Jackie just didn't want to have short fingernails anymore. She wanted long fingernails.
Hi, I'm Jackie Fox.
And the guitar cord kept wrapping around her heels, so she didn't like that. So she didn't want to wear flat shoes. So she quit the band so she could wear high heels and grow her fingernails long. But see, she wanted to go to her own gynecologist too. I mean, it's not a big deal, but it was what happened. It just was kind of like, okay, this sucks. I don't want to talk bad about any of them. I'm trying really hard to bite my tongue. And they got a lot of shit on me, and I got a lot of shit on them. But Jackie was a hypochondriac. And I love you, Jackie, but you were a fucking hypochondriac. I mean, even my noxzema made her sick.
The tensions within the band were really reaching a boiling point. And I remember when we started doing our tour, they'd given me a regular guitar stand, and I had this little collector's item large face, and it was real wobbly, and I had asked our manager, road manager, to get me a sturdier stand for the bass.
Jackie had been having a pretty tough day, and she was feeling very much alone. I was really concerned about her. I was worried about her, for her mental state, because it was just too much.
I walked off stage one night after our last song before the encore, and when I came back on for the encore, they handed me my backup bass, which I didn't like a whole lot. I was like, where's my other bass? And I was like, it's really out of tune. So played the encores with that bass and went back to the hotel that night. And I had this feeling that everybody in the band was whispering about me. I mean, I just knew. And then I thought, okay, you're being paranoid.
Kent Smythe, who was our road manager,
was extremely cruel.
Kent Smythe was enough to make anybody sick, not just Jackie.
He was just a fat Kim Fowler, and he had been bullying Jackie a lot, and Jackie wanted to go home. She was tired of it. She was tired of the abuse from Lita, too. She'd had it.
Finally, somebody told me that my base had broken because the stand had fallen over. And that was just, that was the final straw. And I remember I so wanted to quit the band, but I couldn't bring myself to do it because I thought, what if the band goes on and becomes really famous and I'm not in it? I just won't be able to live with myself. And I really started hating myself because I couldn't bring myself to quit. And when my bass broke, I mean, it was just kind of the last straw. No one had insured it. No one cared. No one could even tell me.
It hadn't been put on the stand right. I don't know if it had been done purposely. I don't know. Jackie could have done it herself. But the bass fell, and it broke. The neck snapped. And when that neck snapped, Jackie snapped. And I just had this funny feeling. I had this really uncomfortable feeling about Jackie. And I was worried. And I decided I was going to go to her room. And I'm walking down the hall, and Kent is coming towards me. And he says, "Don't you go to Jackie's room." And I said, "Fuck you, Kent." I said, "I'm worried about her." He goes, "She's fine, leave her alone." I said, "Fuck you." I mean, I was at that point where it was like, "Fuck you, you fucking asshole! Get the fuck out of my way!" And I walked to her room and I knocked on the door and he left. And she opens the door and she's got a fucking piece of glass in her hand.
I had a room service tray in my room and there was a bottle on it. And I picked up the bottle and just threw it against the wall and it broke. I remember I just started hating myself, and I picked up a piece of the bottle and just like, "I hate you," and I cut myself.
And I grabbed her, and I grabbed her glass, and it was cutting me, and I'm trying to get it. I don't even remember how I got the glass out of her hand. All I know is that she was hacked up, and it was over.
So upset and so furious. To this day, I have a nice wide scar here. Randy Rhodes from Quiet Riot was a really good friend of mine. And I remember in the middle of the night, I called him up and it must have been 4 a.m. in LA. And I remember talking to him and not having enough money to pay the phone bill at the hotel. And I think it was Scott saying, "Well, you know, we'll cover the bill, but now you're on an allowance." And I remember just pretty much eating grilled cheese sandwiches at the hotel because that was all I could afford because of one phone call when my bass broke. That was, I think, what ultimately drove me to quit. I just went, "I don't know who I am anymore. I don't like myself. This is gonna kill me." And I just quit. It's very weird. Many years later, I finally saw the tape of the Tokyo Music Festival. And they went ahead and did it anyway, and I think Joan played bass. And quitting was maybe truly the toughest thing that I've ever done in my life. Okay, we can take a break now.
You all right?
That's so weird.
Here.
All the other things I've talked about, that one sent me over.
Everybody's doing it. It's the weirdest thing.
Yeah, but that one, I mean, you know all the shit.
I know.
This has caught me by surprise.
Everybody, Sandy broke down, Sheree broke down. You know you've heard me break down.
Damn.
The Runaways had trouble and a big neon sign flying right over wherever they stood. And of course, I capitalized on that because that was truly teen authentic reality. And when the teenagers saw these twisted, troubled, tormented goddesses heading their way, of course they responded in all kinds of exciting, multi-symbolistic ways.
After I did that, I guess a few nights later, I started to have this other absolute freak out, and I picked up the phone and I called my mom and I just said, "Get me out of here." And she said, "You get on the next plane." And this is how bad it had gotten. When I quit, I had no money because we were always kept very broke. And the Japanese promoter handed me a bus ticket to get to the airport. And I started crying. Nobody even went with me to the airport. I got put on a bus alone.
I just think it got to a point where it was just too much for her to handle because there was a lot of fans, a lot of pressure, a lot of work.
What do you say? Someone's pushed that far. Who do you blame for that? Someone is to blame.
I was in Japan and don't know why she left. It was time to leave, so she left. And I've heard various stories of why she left or how she left, but I was in Tokyo when it happened.
At the Tokyo Musical Festival, Joan played bass, and we still did the show. Show Must Go On. Leah played guitar, came home, and then we got you. We got Vicky Blue, Vicky Tischler Blue.
Well, when we got back from Japan, you know, we were all really lost. We were so unhappy. We knew we needed to find another bass player. We had a record to do. We had to go back to Europe. So we started auditioning. We only auditioned a couple of girls.
A friend of mine had told me that Jackie had left the band in Japan and that the Runaways were looking for another bass player. And so I called up King Fowley, and he wanted me to come up to Hollywood to audition. The rehearsal studio was at SIR Rehearsal Studios in Hollywood. And I remember walking through the courtyard, you know, into the front door, and it was an old West setting, and they had all this ivy growing and wood paneling and everything. And I pulled open that door, and I walked in, and they were all sitting there, the whole band, and they just stared at me. It was a frozen moment in time. And all of a sudden, Lita goes, "Oh my God, she does look like me."
She looked a lot like Lita, which was a big problem, because Lita was not happy with Vicky.
We had so many bass players. We went through bass players like toilet rolls. There were a lot of them. I have to pee. Ugh.
Then we started playing some songs. I don't remember what songs we played. And the rehearsal went pretty well. And then they told me to leave the room so they could all talk about me. And so I walked outside, and I remember standing in the lobby just going, "Fuck." I wanted this gig so bad that I thought I'm gonna die.
Finally, Kim walked out,
and all of a sudden, Cherie stands up and goes, "Welcome to the Runaways."
And it was like, oh my God!
Ow!
By the time Vicky joined the band, the Runaways were out of their minds already. It was hard for Vicky just to jump in and fit in because, you know, we were lunatics by that point. And she was young, and she'd never been in a rock band before, so it was just a learning experience for her. She was trying to figure it all out herself. We became good friends.
Lita worked with me a lot musically, teaching me all the old Runaway songs, and we became pretty close. She didn't like the fact that I looked like her. You know, that was a little bit of a problem, so she suggested I get a perm.
Because we weren't so tight-knit as a band, each girl was sort of off in their own world, like Carrie Crome. I don't know her. I've seen her, but she was somebody else's responsibility, you know? Well, Vicky Blue sort of became my responsibility. And like I said before, she came into the band at a really hard time where the girls were tired and fucked up and were pissed off. And then here comes Vicky. "Hi, I'm a fresh, new, clean bass player. Hi, I'm really happy to be in this band, and I'm really gonna try as hard as I can. What do you want me to do? You tell me and I'll do it. We just want you to play bass and be great, just like we are, Vicky." Vicky was like, okay. And I was so pissed off with all the other girls in the band that I was happy to be with Vicky. She was like a breath of fresh air.
The first photo session we had with me and the band started out really fine and everything. It was with Barry Levine. He was our photographer. He did all of our album covers and most of our publicity stuff. And Lita picked me up. We got to Barry Levine's studio, and we're waiting for Cherie, and she finally comes in close to 2 hours late, and Lita's pissed. And Cherie, you know, is saying basically,
it was due to her family. She and her sister shared this car. And so the photo session goes on, and we're shooting these individual shots. We had done the group shots. And all of a sudden, Cherie announces to everybody that she has to leave. And it's 2 hours early.
I had gotten to the photo shoot probably about an hour early. I had to be home by 7 to let my sister. We shared a car, my twin sister and I. She had acting class, and that was something I had to do. We shared a car, I had to be home by 7. And I had told Barry Levine this. Well, Lita shows up 2 hours late. By the time the session is rolling, really rolling, I have to leave. And Barry took his camera, he threw it across the room, breaking it, screaming, ranting, and raving, God damn it, right when the session's going, fuck Cherie, this bird.
So the minute Cherie announced that she had to leave early, Barry Levine, our photographer, threw his Nikon on the ground and it just smashed into a million pieces. And I just remember thinking, oh my God, it's a fucking Nikon, you know? And the thing smashed and Cherie went into the dressing room.
And I just went, whoa. Barry, you know I have to go. You know I have to leave. You said it was over. Fuck you, fuck this shit. Throwing things, knocking things over. I say, exit stage left. Pew! And I head for the dressing room. I think the sooner I can get out of here, because I can feel the room rumbling, man. I know that the shit's gonna go down.
When she announced that she had to leave early, Lita lost her mind completely, and all hell broke loose. And Cherie went into one of the dressing rooms and started to change. And
I close my door, and I'm trying to get my clothes on as best I can, and Lita comes and kicks that door. She kicks it down.
Bam! Okay, and Lita kicked in the dressing room door, went flying, and she basically grabbed Cherie and, you know, threw up against the wall and said, it's the band or your fucking family. We are sick of your family.
And of course, I was sitting there, I said, this is it. She's gonna kill me. Finally, all these years of pent-up aggravation and hate is going to be lashed out, and she's gonna take my head off.
Well, I had had enough. My patience ran out. I blew up at Cherie in Barry Levine's studio, and I guess I yelled at her one too many times, and she quit the band. She didn't show up. She was 2 hours late showing up. She was always late. And, you know, I don't know if it was her fault or the manager's fault, because the manager was too busy having a relationship with her rather than trying to make sure that she was doing what was best for her career. He didn't care about her career. He cared more about what was in her pants and how many drugs she was taking. I mean, I took my career serious, and I wanted to make that dream happen that Kim Fowley had told me about when we first had that very first conversation before I auditioned for The Runaways. He gave me a vision, and I wanted that vision. I wanted it. So anyway, that day at Barry Levine's studio, I walked in and I was all mouth. And of course, being Italian, got a lot of piss and vinegar that came out that day. And she left. Cherie left. She said, I cannot work with this woman. I guess I scared her.
Well, she did. She did. She basically said, we have chosen the band. We have family, we have band. Either the band is going to be first priority or your family is going to be first priority. I said, sorry, Lita. My family is first priority. I'm out of here. I said, I'm gone. This is it. I don't want to fucking do this anymore. I don't want to deal with you anymore. I don't want to deal with this hell anymore. I am so sick and so through with this shit. All right? That's it. I'm done.
Cherie pretty much said, that's it. I'm out of here. And Lita goes, good, split. And she walked to the door, opened the door, turned around, and she was, Vicky, are you coming with me? When she called me on that, I just said, I'm staying. She walked out, and that was it. She left.
And by the time I got home, Kim Fowley was on the phone with my father. I pick up the phone. He goes, Cherie, is it true if you quit the band? I said, that's right, Kim. I've quit the band. Good for you. I'm glad you stood your ground. In 2 weeks, I was in the studio making Beauty's Only Skin Deep. And the Runaways were making their next record.
And it was over. A sad ending, but a memorable one. Kind of went out with a bang.
The next day we had a band meeting, and what happened was Joan had to take over the job of being the lead singer. And we sat around the rehearsal studio that day, and we, you know, we're trying to figure out, okay, what songs can she sing that Cherie sang?
By the third album, Lita Ford was still in the band, Joan Jett was still in the band, Sandy West was still in the band, Cherie Curry had left the band, and Jackie Fox had left the band. Vicky Blue took the place of Jackie Fox. Cherie left one day when she and Lita had heated words. I wasn't there either. Oh, she's not in the band anymore. Okay, Joan, I guess you're gonna have to carry it. Okay, Joan carried it.
And there's this flash of insecurity that Joan had. And she was like, I don't know if I can do it. And she did it, and she did it really well. And that moment, I think, was the only moment of camaraderie that I ever experienced in the band, where we all kind of banded around each other because we weren't close.
At that point, when Joan became the lead singer, there was a lot of drugs. Joan was so out of it. I was out of it. We were pretty much all out of it. But Joan, she was a good lead singer. She was a good front man. And she had a lot of weight on her back to take over that position.
We were growing disenchanted with Kim Fowley, and we were being courted by Blondie's management, Toby Maimus and Peter Leeds.
Kim wanted out. He wanted to cash out. He got the money for the record advances, the publisher advances, and he didn't believe in the band after Cherie left. So like most of the male record executives of that time, and maybe even of this time, without the blonde bombshell, without the sex pot, they didn't see a viability in the band. Jones, tough, butch, tomboy kind of arrogance, you know, rock and roll thing, didn't work for them. They needed a sexy chick. He wanted to cash out, so he offered to sell me his management contract, knowing I was interested. We talked about that back and forth, lawyers, partners, dollars, you know, et cetera. And in the course of that time, he alienated the Runaways more and more with his eccentricity.
I mean, I'd never encountered anybody like Kim before. And he'd come in and he'd just scream with this rhetoric of dog cunt, dog shit. He's weird. You know, he's a really weird guy, really a strange guy. But also in that strangeness, I mean, he taught me a lot of things too. He taught me that if you can have a vision, if you can think of something, no matter how extreme it is, and you're willing to do the work, you can go out there and accomplish anything. And that I learned from Kim.
The split from Kim Fowley was very hostile. Yeah, we hired security guards for the band. We were very worried he was going to take some kind of physical action against me or the band. Luckily, he didn't, because he backed down and just went away like a whipped puppy.
I don't remember it very well, but Kim suddenly left without much resistance. I mean, he was gone, and then we had Toby managing us.
I look at it as though I had gone through college to study and learn how to be the real deal. And I just feel like there wasn't anything that I didn't learn in the Runaways. The Runaways just learned everything the hard way by touring and being ripped off. And we had a lot of great moments too. We toured 3 months through the United States with the Ramones. The Ramones would put chicken wire up in front of the stage because the audience would throw handfuls of change and all kinds of crap at them. And then when we came on, we'd take it down. Because they never threw nothing at us, except like condoms and stupid stuff. We toured in a little station wagon. All of us girls crammed into a little station wagon, driving through the snow.
We spent 4 months living in a station wagon and touring the country during the worst snowstorms ever in the history of recorded weather. The station wagon was caked with quarter pounder wrappers everywhere. Every day, we each had at least 2 quarter pounders from McDonald's. So, I mean, multiply that by 4,
times 3 months or 4 months, and it was a pretty disgusting car. But it was kind of fun, and we'd be like smashed in the car, you know, riding like this the whole time.
I remember I learned how to sleep like this with my knees on the back of the chair in front of me. And I'd sleep like this. This was my position, man. When you're in that age, you gotta sleep. Sleep's very important when you're a teenager. It really is.
After that tour, I couldn't listen to the Ramones again, and I couldn't eat anything from McDonald's again.
The girls started telling you stories about you having seizures that mm-hmm. you weren't even aware of at the time
yeah.
when it was happening.
When I started the film, I didn't know this, but I was having seizures in the band. And it was a pretty... Okay, all right, let me move on. When I started shooting this movie, Sandy and I spent a lot of time together, and we hadn't seen each other in a really long time. And I gotta figure out a different way to launch into this. Hang on a sec. The infamous medical condition, not drugs, as everybody always refers to it, was due to the fact that I was having seizures when I was in the band. When I was about 10 years old, I had a horseback riding accident, fell off a horse, hit my head, had a concussion, and developed epilepsy. I didn't know I was having these seizures until Sandy told me. Nobody told me. And there were times in the band where things would get very surreal for me. And I didn't know if I was paranoid or what was happening, but things were not, they weren't right. You know, I couldn't quite piece information together, and I couldn't quite figure out why I couldn't figure things out. And finding out in retrospect that it was due to me having seizures, and they started getting paranoid.
It was scary, you know, I didn't know what to do. Maybe everybody was concerned about it because they didn't know what to do with you. Maybe they felt like your health couldn't take that kind of toll. Can I smoke now? How am I doing?
I mean, you can go there with my stuff. You know that.
It's about all I remember.
Yeah.
You know, I don't mean to blank out, but a lot of shit I don't remember. Well, there's like so many at a table in like a little European dining room or restaurant off the highway. I think he just fell off the chair and went down the ground. Started going, you know, convulsions. A few of us like surrounded her, and I think somebody knew what to do. And I know what to do now because I've seen it so much in jail. What more do you want me to try to remember? But I can't, I'm blanking out on your, yeah.
Let's talk about
you.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, we want to talk about that? I don't. You know, it's unimportant to anything. It never affected anything, so. Me as a person overlooked it. Me as somebody who's a bandmate and somebody had to tour with her and be with her all the time and be your friend and take her under my wing. Because she was in the band the least amount of time, I think that she does have a better overview of the career of the Runaways. She's not so much caught up on the inside. She can see what's going on better than we can sometimes. When you're stuck in the middle of something, you don't see it so well. Does that make any sense?
When we got back from our American tour, we were writing songs and getting ready to record And Now the Runaways. And they brought in a series of producers, and we were going to work with Mike Chapman, Phil Wayman, a whole bunch of glam English producers that we liked a lot. And when John Alcock came in, he had produced The Who, he had produced Thin Lizzy. We were really excited to get him. But he was just... He just brought this cloud of darkness to the Runaways that we had not ever been able to achieve on our own.
He was a British producer, and He had an engineer named Will Reed Dick that he worked with. So the girls like to say they had a production team with Real Ball, John Alcock and Will Reed Dick.
The minute John Alcock came into the picture, everything went sideways. The problem was he didn't like Joan, and he didn't like me. And essentially, he wanted to make an album with Sandy and Lita.
Best drumming I ever did, best drum sound I ever got. The guy was an amazing producer. The only bummer part was that Joan didn't have a good rapport with John Alcock. He didn't seem to believe in her, and she thought she was kind of being shoved out a little bit. So it was hard to keep her encouraged.
He was more into hard rock, like Sandy and Lita. Joan and I liked glitter and glam. Big conflict there. So he was concentrating a lot more on the big drum sound and heavy leads and everything. He did not want me to play bass. He did not want me or Joan to be in the studio. And everybody was pretty uncomfortable about the whole thing.
I remember from meetings that I was included in that John Alcock thought that you weren't capable enough as a musician to play on that album, that he would prefer Lita Ford played on the bass tracks.
Which was fine with me. I mean, that wasn't that big of a deal, but the way it was done, you know, everything was secretive. You know, Sandy and Lita were having secret meetings. Joan and I were, you know, excluded from a lot of things in that album.
There was a split in the band going on. Joan became very interested in the punk scene, very enamored of the honesty and the reality of it, and Lita and Sandy were leaning more towards the hard rock, heavy metal side of things, and guessing that Vicky just wanted to go ride horses. So this created a schism in the band musically, and that created ultimately the downfall of the band.
The pop was going, and the more heavier rock was coming in.
Sandy and I were always over at his house, but no, we never, I don't think we ever worked with him. Did he ever produce anything, Joan Alcock? Oh, he did? Oh, did he produce that? Oh, shit. And now the Runaways. God. I don't even remember being in the studio with him. I remember Sandy threw up banana daiquiris all over his living room. And then I remember trying to use the phone the next day, and the phone was sticking because it had shit, chunks of banana in it.
He always had the hots for me. But I'm like, no, John, it's not in your dreams. Is it you and I are ever going to become an item? I'm your friend. I'm your buddy, you know? But he was a control freak, you know? And he was a control freak because he wanted most of my time and took away my time from my home life and my other social life. And then the music thing. What about the music thing, you know? I remember there was a lot of manipulation with John showing us... you know, just advising us with contracts that weren't looking too good. And actually, it seemed like he was, you know, saying the truth. You know, grow up, take your time, develop yourself musically. And I agreed with all that, so did Lita. But there was a lot of conflict because I think the John Alcock, Lita Ford, Sandy West wanted to go do that and play, maybe play a little heavier music. And Joan didn't. And at the same time, we were all using a lot of drugs, except for you. You didn't use drugs. So that never helps any situation.
Yeah, John Alcock, when he came into the picture, it just seemed like the drugs and the alcohol intensified tremendously. And nobody was communicating. And I mean, I didn't know any, you know, I didn't know Lita anymore. I didn't know Sandy, I didn't know Joan anymore. I couldn't relate to them, you know, because I didn't get high. And it was pretty intense, you know. Nobody was really getting along.
So we ended up with John Alcock by default. He was available, he was good, he was successful, he was interested, and he tore the band apart.
I quit during the middle of that album. I'm not actually on the album at all. Lita played all the bass parts. And, you know, it wasn't fun anymore. It had become a grind. It had become ugly, really ugly. And I didn't want any part of it, and I couldn't get away fast enough. You know, I wanted out, so I quit.
the girls started arguing a lot, and the different ones were quitting, and then it finally just fell apart.
I remember just pulling apart. It was Joan and Toby, and me and Lita and John. Just, you go your way, you know, and we'll go ours then.
Well, the band fell apart towards the end because musical differences. I think Joan got pretty fed up with whatever it was that she was doing, being the front man, and I got pretty fed up with it too. I wanted to play hard rock, and Joan wanted to go off and play kind of a glitter glam rock, you know. So yeah, everybody went their own direction. I was like, okay, fine, bye. No, I don't remember, honestly.
It ended with a lot of acrimony and trying to figure out how to end it without killing everybody. Nobody trusted anybody else. There was a lot of open hostility. Basically, I remember we sat down at Gold Star Studios in Hollywood, where Phil Spector made all those great records, where Johnny Alcock was working on some other project. And we agreed to break the band up.
I remember the decision of me and Lita splitting apart from Joan and Toby. And that was pretty mind-boggling. And it's like the band's disbanded, and it hurt. You know, and I really was a part of looking out for these girls and watching them grow up and growing up with them. So when all that ripping and tearing went on, my heart was ripping and tearing. And that's when you find yourself feeling lost. Where do I go? Where do I fit in? What do I do? How do I go about it? And when it hits you, it's really hard. All of a sudden, there's nothing. You got nothing. When you felt like you had everything and you're happy, just the way things were. And then there's nothing.
And at that point, everybody was really in need, desperate need of a good year off, from drugs and everything. I mean, it had been 5 years. We were together for 5 years when the Runaways broke up. We started in 1975 and we broke up in 1980. And, you know, everything just kind of got so intense. Everybody was doing so many drugs and we were tired. We'd had enough.
Joan was caught up in the whole punk scene. And her lifestyle, and she was devastated by the split in the band, by these arguments and fights with the girls she really believed were her sisters, but she didn't put up much of a fight for her band. But I think she was also drinking a lot. There was a lot of substance abuse going on at that time. So I think she basically was powerless to fight Sandy and Lita because she wasn't at full strength.
John Alcock was luring us, me and Lita, into starting our own band. And that involved a lot of drug use and drinking. Lita kind of gave up and started going her own way, doing her own thing. And I just was continuing to party with John, doing some pretty crazy stuff, you know. I found myself, they call it taxing, when you go collecting money for people that owe drug debts. I was protecting people. And this was my lifestyle all of a sudden.
You know, it's not all what really happens to you. It's what happened to your child. Maybe this angel will live. And that's what hurts. Because you know, you feel like you're very helpless. And there's not much that you can really do except pray a lot. And I did a lot of that. We try to keep in contact, but, you know, when she was off on with her problems, she really didn't contact any of the family. And there were a lot of holidays that we didn't see Sandy. I'm not doing too good here. Oh, not really. You kidding?
It's okay.
I don't think it should have ever happened. I don't think the Runaways ever should have broke up. Because we were the most awesome band, and it hurts more than anything. That band could have kept on going. And I think it's because of really fucked up people that were involved, and it wasn't us. It was those other assholes that wanted to manipulate and control and tear us apart. Why? Greed? Greed's an ugly thing. Power's an ugly thing. Jealousy is a very ugly thing. No reason that band should have broke up. Why? I ask you, why? I ask everybody why. I'm asking the girls, why? You know, I don't kind of feel it left in your guts, you guys, but it left me with I love Runaways, but I'm like still broken up about it. You know, people through my life, just get over it. Just that's in your past, your has been. He got punched out for that. I don't mean to come off so violent. I'm an angry person inside about it. It blows me away that we can't get back together and do a world tour and a great album. Why? Can you do it for me? Am I being greedy? Is that asking too much? Is it being silly to say that it's okay that Sandy just been doing construction for 20 years? That I don't have any talent left, you know? I mean, what are these people thinking? Don't they miss playing together? Aren't they sad we broke up? I don't know what else to say. I'm just upset. Lisa, I know we live
in different worlds. Of course, we were proud. And then as the band started deteriorating, and going down, I know that it was a disappointment for her, but it was kind of as a mom and a dad and the rest of the family, it was kind of a relief in a way.
I was trying to kid myself by being a bartender, veterinarian assistant, which I loved, or, you know, the dangerous adventures of me. You know, maybe that was a self-destructive side of me. Maybe I was out to just push it, you know? I was fearless. Now you go down and you break somebody's door down, and they got guns all over you, and you got guns all over them. You don't know who's gonna get killed. It's on the floor. Time now, guarding people. That's scary. And then I had to break somebody's arm once. I had to shove a gun down someone's throat once and watch them shit their pants. And then you look around and you go, I just wanted to be a drummer and a rock man. I just wanted to be out on the road with Joan and Lita and Cherie and you, you know, just having fun, like the good old days.
I don't give a shit. Can I say shit and fuck?
No, I'm not gonna talk about that.
Such a fucking liar.
I've given you a lot of stuff that's already probably gonna get one or both of us sued. Which we're gonna have to talk about.
Hey, Vicky.
Okay.
I wore this blue jumpsuit on stage, and I don't like it.
Well, we were gonna do this, something that, do different. I don't wanna do it that way. Let's go back to what you were talking about before. It's a fucking another story. I hate fucking going there, yeah.
Well, let's back up a little bit.
I don't remember.
I'm having a seizure!
Now I see why everybody was so upset with me, because I had them all staring into the sun.
There were a couple of things.
What did you just say?
Porsche.
What do you remember?
When Sheree wanted to tap dance to blackmail. She was gonna come out at the beginning and like tap dance instead of me doing my little bass solo. And the whole place is just like, you are not tap dancing to the Runaways. Sheree always, I mean, God bless Sheree. She always wanted to put in something more artistic.
Hey,
what?
Do it again, Vic. One more time. One more time.
Okay, here we go. Here we go.
You gotta get over next to her, babe.
Oh, there we go.
There you go.
Runaways tattoos.
Runaways. Bass player tattoos. Bass player reunion.
There's no. Don't you know what reunion is?
I had always wanted to start a band.
One more time. Five, four, three, two,
and. I had always wanted to start a band.
Shall I respond to that? The machines are going on the whole time, right? Of course they are. I don't care. I understand libel laws, and I understand reality, I understand common sense.
What's the most eventful thing that happened to you in that?
Nothing happened.
Sitting, eating my apple pie,
But I was never asked to join the Runaways, no. I think they were a bit too young for me, really.
Okay, why don't we push a little tighter? Push a little. Yeah.
I just love the fact that you're this little director chick. It's very cute. And you let the whole thing, you got the whole movement going. I'm very proud of you.
I love you.
Hi, I'm Jackie Fox, and these are my breasts.
Oh.
I was born a tough ass. I was, man. I mean, I got piss and vinegar flowing through my veins. But I don't know, I guess I'm just, because I'm Lita. And that's it. What else do you need to be tough?
What do you think is the toughest thing you've ever done?
Oh, a penis. What about it? Penis, a curved penis. This is Lita Ford. Hang tight for Edge Play, a film about the Runaways.
You've been a very, very bad girl, Vicky.
Hold on.
We wanted to do what we loved, and what we loved to do was rock and roll.
This is Vicky Blue's movie.
This is Vicky Blue's blackmail material for the next 10 years. The bass player's revenge.
Yes. Yeah, kitty, kitty, kitty.